No, no, I've never been to Beagle Point before.
Alright, it's your loss.
Oh, really? You know what? I will go there now. I mean, why not? Got to check that box someday. Might as well be it now. Time to dust off my exploration Python. It's a 60 light years range build. I've made a video about it, if you're interested in its details. It's possible to reach Beagle Point in a ship with 30 light years jump range. So with 60 light years, I'm laughing right here. Not to mention, I operate in Colonia, not in the bubble. So I'm half of the way there already. Yeah, it's one more reason, among others, why the clever money has left Fargoid-infested bubble for Colonia. Aye, them bugs can burn the bubble to the ground for all I care. I will take my time with this trip, expect some delays with my uploading schedule. It's probably going to be my longest video to date, I'm going to enjoy this trip. Also, I will skip the supermassive black hole in the center of the galaxy, Sagittarius A star. I've been there 100 times already, it's no longer that special to me. But I will go to few special places along the way. Maybe I will discover one really cool place of my own, who knows? It's always a possibility when one goes deep into the black. And one can hardly go deeper than Beagle Point. And there's my first stop. Always a pleasure to go there. That's what I call a star cluster. It's only part of the reason this system is special. Main reason is this, a black hole near a B-type star. It's even got its own name in the EDSM, the Maw of Kronos. It was discovered by the Commander X fighting Falcon X on a Mercury 7 expedition. Expedition that I was also a part of. You may recognize this place actually, I used the shots of it in my end credits. I have to admit, it looks different in Odyssey. Also, I've arrived at a different angle this time around. We had a fun idea, each participant of the expedition was to tag with his name one body in this system. Commander Yannick, who organized the expedition, was granted an honor of tagging the black hole itself. There's Beamzy. Commander Patreklos. Commander Sky Yeti, who made this journey in White Type 7. We dubbed it the Caravan. Commander Smudge. Kel Solar, who flew a Corvette on this expedition. Starduck, yes. And here's Colt Tallinn. Commander Adermon was also with us. Commander Watercant, who was recording our shenanigans. Commander Deathbane, yeah, I remember all of those people. I also have my name here. I've tagged that class 5 Kaz Giant. Not everybody was able to put his or her name in here. As some random asshole came and put his stupid name on the rest of the bodies. Screw you, Commander Manwe. More like man we. Anyway, time to go. I'm only about 3000 light years from Colonia and there's one more place I want to visit on the way. This is the place. You wonder why this system is worth a visit? Well, take a look at the system map. Not one, not two, but three Earth-like worlds, all in close proximity, orbiting each other. And on top of it, there's also terraformable water world and high metal content world in a spit distance of those as well. This system was discovered by the Commander Stayla, who is a member of our faction, Colonia Citizens Network. He deployed his fleet carrier here, CCN Tranquility, for the DSSA program. It orbits one of those Earth-likes. La Vita Nova is the system name in the archives of Elite Dangerous Star Map. It truly is a place where you can let loose your imagination. Are there primitive civilizations living on those planets? Commander Izilanka pointed out it's a great setup for a sci-fi novel, without the need of an FTL. Those planets will be reachable with our current level of technology. If you're a writer, you're welcome. If there is an intelligent life there, they obviously saw the arrival of Commander Stayla's huge ship, tearing space-time itself with a flash of light and a distant thunder. Of course they did, they have to be mighty interested in astronomy. They have two planets like their own on the sky, for God's sakes. Must be terrifying for them, aliens came, didn't even bother to hide themselves. Didn't make any attempts of contact, just watching silently from the sky. And they want you to know they are here and are not fazed by any defenses your planet may have. Meanwhile, to us, it's just a glorified repair station with a nice vista. It's going to be my stop. From here, my trip to Beagle Point truly starts. Right, no time to lose. Let's get this trip to the Beagle Point going. Farewell, La Vita Nova. Farewell, terrified civilizations. I've got few thousand light years to cover, just for the fun of it. That's strange. I've got a bookmark of a system that I haven't visited yet. Must be one of the waypoints of a Minerva Centaurus expedition. One of the waypoints that I skipped back then. Might as well plot there and see what's in there. 140 jumps, no sweat. By the way, if you happen to know when and where Obsidian Ant will be, just let me know, okay? I'm pretty sure all of you guys know how to get a boost from a neutron star. But still, there might be a viewer who does not, so let me show you, buddy. What you want to do is fly directly into the highly radioactive jet of a neutron star. You want to miss the body exclusion zone, so you aim at the middle of the jet, at a angle that puts the star behind you. Enter it slowly. That means everything is fine. And there you go, that's it. Supercharging your equipment by using neutron stars is easy. I always say, neutron stars are your friends. It's the white dwarfs that want to kill you. You want to be careful with those. It's important to come up with objectives on those trips, to fight off the boredom of the repetition. For example, I would like to find a landable body with an atmosphere and a ring system. Alternatively, I would also like to find a body with 100% water atmo. I know those are out there. Both of those things are quite rare, but we can give it a try. Nope, nope, nope. Damn it! Okay, we need a secondary objective. Let's say a Lagrange cloud. That should be easy to find in nebulas. That one will do. Hello, hello! A Herbig star. What is a Herbig star? It's a young protostar that will become either a B or A type main sequence star. Meaning those are not burning hydrogen yet. It's not a feature in Elite, but there should be a massive gas cloud covering it. In fact, those should be only present in star formation regions, rich in interstellar gas, such as nebulas. But whatever, I'm willing to gloss over it. Brown water world? Cool. I've almost reached the nebula. Let's see if I'm lucky today. And the answer is... I'm not. I can't find any Lagrange clouds here. Well, that's how it goes sometimes. It's a vast galaxy. Not every system hides a treasure. This one was hiding a DSSA carrier. Hey, I've got an idea. Let's visit every single type of atmosphere. This should be doable, if I find that water atmo, that is. I will also try to pick planets no further than one astronomical unit away from their parent star. 100% nitrogen atmo on a rocky ice world. First, the twilight zone. Not bad, not bad. Quite pretty, actually. What about the sunny side? Coloration of the sky reminds me of my channel colors. Frankly, it almost looks like a proper daylight here. Lose the stars and get some clouds, and yeah, I will buy it. Overall, very nice. Next. 100% neon, also rocky ice world. It appears to be much more transparent, but still blue even in the twilight zone. Let's check out how it looks during noon hours. It's darker, that's for sure. Okay, that's neon atmo. Next. 100% oxygen high metal content world. Oh man, this one looks very pretty from the orbit. I like it already. It looks very pretty in the dusk zone as well. Update 9 really did the trick with the lighting. You know the drill, sunny side now. There are purple hues here as well. I'm not sure if it's because of the atmosphere type or is it because of the type of the star on the sky. 100% argon. It's quite brown here. I wouldn't want to live on this rock. I guess it's got its charms. It's just not my taste. Argon might be a noble gas, but it certainly does not look like it. More like a peasant gas. Non-reactive farts. Yup, brown in the daylight as well. There's life here, I'll just quickly scan it. See that star? It's quite wild to think I was there, near it, just few minutes ago. I'm still, after all this time, impressed by the scale of this game. Got to say, my favorite so far has to be 100% oxygen atmo. I know, it's pretty exotic stuff. Helium-rich body. Even though it says neon-rich. Let's see if the inclusion of neon will make this atmo appear very thin. That line cutting through mountain chain looks appealing.
Oh yeah, definitely thin atmo. You can even see interstellar gas through it. Also, my canopy seems to be leaking. See? Told you it was helium-rich atmosphere. No surprises on the sun side. Looks just like 100% neon.
Let's take a break for a moment, as I'm just one jump away from my mysterious bookmark. Nothing is tagged, except this Earth-like. I guess this is it. Nice find, Commander Yannick. It reminds me of Kinesi system. Okay, time to get cracking. I'm just 11,000 light years away from Colonia and I have to make another 35,000 light years to Beagle Point still. Whoa, that's a entry point with a jump scare potential. One can go through one of those stars if arriving at an unfortunate angle. Glad I didn't. Damn, it's ugly in here. Come on, Frontier, you can do better. Those nebulas are in serious need of an update. What's this? Lagrange cloud, got to be. It is! Nice, our secondary objective has been accomplished. This cloud is red. Yeah, duh, but there are many other colors out there. Of those clouds. It appears to be some kind of glitch with shadows going on. Doesn't ruin it for me though. What do we have here? Solid mineral spheres. Yeah, I saw those before. The ship is being thrown around here. It jiggles like crazy. Pretty windy in here, I guess. If that's how it's going to be in the future on thick Atmo planets, then landing on them might prove tricky. I'm looking forward to that. Uh-oh, that's not good. Come on, work, dammit! Last thing I need is to be stranded somewhere between Scatam Centaurus and Perseus arms. Must have been all that supercharging that caused the damage. Still, I want to visually inspect the outsides of the ship. I will find a place to land and do that. 100% sulfur dioxide atmosphere, smells like rotten eggs. But it will do. Not a bad place, didn't look that interesting from the orbit. Frameshift drive breakdowns are definitely not something one would want. I will double check what else is in this system. Oops, that hurt actually. Shields are gone and half of the hull. That's why you want grade 5 heavy duty armor modification on your basic bulkheads. On your exploration ship. It saved me just now. This 60 light years Python has, as far as it makes no difference, the same amount of hull health as a stock Federal Corvette. Yeah, things do not look good. Oh no, I've scratched my paint! Over there, what's left of it at least. Main thermal vents look good, no damage here. Secondary vents appear to be working as intended as well. Maintenance hatch. Yeah, I've lost the keycode that opens it somewhere. We're not getting there. If you're asking yourself, what is all this random garbage melded onto the hull? It's extra protection. If it wasn't for those rods over here, this little crash might have been much more serious. Could have bended the nose of the ship without those. Right, inspections over. Let's fix it. First of all, modules. Select the module and order it to be fixed. Like that. To fix those, one will need an out-of-field maintenance unit. I've got two. So one can repair the other. as one AFMU can't repair itself, because a module has to be powered down during repairing. FSD repaired. Now I just have to turn it back on. Good thing I can fix other modules all at once, not one by one. It's a little thing, but it still makes a difference. Everything is at 100%, except power plant. I can't repair it. If I switch it off, what will power the maintenance unit, eh? Mouse in a wheel? Where do I get the wheel? One would have to have handheld battery powered AFMU and ship interiors to fix power plant. Anyway, let me fix the hull now. First of all, I have to get some air. Why? Repair limpets need some room to maneuver. What if one does not have any limpets? That's not a problem, as every ship has a fabricator on board. It's called the synthesizer and it can make some stuff for you. Limpet synthesis is pretty costly, not gonna lie. Thankfully, that basic blueprint uses only grade 1 materials. Get to work, limpet! Huh? Turns out it doesn't need that much space. It's such a good feeling to see that icon. Everything is going to be fine. Limpet expired, got to fire up the next one. Those basic limpets do not have plenty of nanobots in them. I might have to fabricate a bit more. Nice. Ships fully repaired. Good as new. Last thing to do is to dump the rest of the limpets if you have any left. No need to have them, I can always make more. It's just an unnecessary weight that will slow me down. Now I can get going. That being said, I didn't gone that far, and it has been 2 weeks already, and I'm barely halfway there. If I keep current pace, I will reach Beagle Point on the New Year's Eve, and I will be back in Colonia in February. I don't want to keep you guys waiting that long for this video. So, to hell with exploring and setting objectives. Beagle Point, that's what I want to see. So let's just binge it there. Oh fuck me, white dwarf. Okay, I can do it. Just got to be careful, really careful. Those things are really dangerous. Okay, it's done. Let's get the hell out of here. Ah, that's more like it. Much safer. I'm on the border of the Abyss region, just 5,000 light years away from the Beagle Point. How many jumps is that? Can I even plot there through all that empty space? Yes, I can! 108 jumps and I'm there! It's getting pretty empty and dark in front of me. I will bravely keep going though. Now entering the Abyss. Bring it, I'm not scared much. And here I am, Beagle Point. Yep, this is it. This system was discovered and named by the Commander Kamzel, who organized Distant Worlds expedition. There is a DSSA fleet carrier owned by him parked here for use by such random assholes like myself. Frankly, the system itself is nothing special. What makes it special is the fact that it's the farthest place you can reach from the bubble in an unengineered ship. Thing is, my ship is engineered, and that means I can go even farther, like Ishum's reach. To get there, one will need not only engineered ship, but also FSD injections. So yeah, let's go there instead. It's not far from here. Screw Beagle Point. Aye, now that I have been here, I have the right to say it. It might have been a challenge to get here back in the day, but today any schmuck can do it. Abyss is no longer dangerous or tricky if you're in a proper ship. In a proper ship, it's boring. Even my NAV computer had no problems plotting through it. Ishum's Reach, not Beagle Point, is where it's at nowadays. And I will see it as well. Would be foolish not to. We are not there yet, but according to the NAV computer, we can't go farther. See? Impossible to get there, not with my current jump range. And yet, I plan to get there with two jumps, through this system. How? Let's cook! Jumponium. For the first jump, I only need standard FSD injection. There, done. Now, the last jump. It's going to be much more tricky. Premium FSD injection will give me 121 light years range. But, as you can see, the system is 125 light years away. So how I could jump there? I need to lose some weight. The answer is fuel. I will have to jump there with almost empty tanks. Thankfully, the star itself is scoopable. Still, I'm kind of nervous about it. Okay, let's see if I can pull it off. First, injecting frameshift drive. Second, dumping fuel. Boost, boost, boost! Damn it, this will take hours. Or I can just go here and back a few times. Shit, I've wasted a premium jumponium. Okay, tanks are almost empty. If you're a fuel rat, this site must have really slay you. Injecting FSD. Again. Yes, I can make it. And here we are. The end of the road. Can't go farther. True end of the galaxy. There's Centralis, 46,500 light years away. And there's Sol somewhere, I guess. Well, time to go. I will spare you the trip back. Next stop, Colonia. Okay, I lied. I've got a good reason to make a stop here. Water atmosphere. Finally! Tagged by Commander Stela. Well, of course it is. Who else it might have been? Regardless, I'm still very happy. Did I tell you those are very rare? Those are very rare. So let's check it out. It's a tiny, tiny moon. Quite surprised, actually, it can hold atmosphere. Hey, I'll take it. It's still bigger than Hearthstone, believe it or not. Very deep blue atmo, if I can say so. Not as thin as neon, but still quite transparent. Might be because this body is so small. Well, that would be a scientific explanation. Got to check how it looks in full sun. Is it me or the sky got even darker? Maybe. Okay, now we know 100% water atmosphere, somewhat transparent dark blue hues, regardless of where you land. I will still need to find one that's on a bigger body to be sure. Someday. You know, there is actually a point to this journey besides visiting Beagle Point. Some people who do not know much about Elite believe there is not much to see out there. That there are like 5 planet types repeating in every system. Wrong! We have seen just on this trip neutron stars, Hebrig stars, nebulas, Lagrange clouds. We saw Earth-like worlds, water worlds and amazing black holes. We have scanned alien flora. We have flew through nitrogen, oxygen, neon, argon,
helium
and water atmospheres, and that's not even half of those out there. It's no mystery why people who want to see it all spend months exploring the black. Frankly, the only thing that can get close to elite when it comes to exploration is space engine. Unless you're 5, then No Man's Sky might seem more appealing. But I'm not here to trash talk No Man's Sky. It's got its target audience, I'm just not in it. Let's leave it at that. If I could have one complaint, then I would say that shinies are a bit too sparse out there. Thankfully, there is a codex that will tell you where to exactly find those worth seeing things. So there is a way around the problem already in game, sort of. I'm almost home, back in Colonia. Now if you'll excuse me, got one bartender to impress. Hey, guess where I have been? Beagle Point and Ishum's Reach. What do you say now, eh?
Please do feel free to waste my time.
You cheeky bitch!